Okay, welcome to session 10. This is the last formal lecture session. The last session that we, after this, is going to be just a very quick review of the assignment for component 3. So we're just about done, and this shouldn't take too long. What I'm going to do here in session 10 is have a little bit of a discussion about some examples of benefit cost analysis. And I've got a set of them up here. I've got one up here called the Tellico Dam example, and that, you're not probably old enough, but not too many years ago, we had this epic battle between building a dam and an endangered species, and so I'll talk about that. We have another benefit cost study that happened here in Iowa that I reviewed a few years ago called West Tarkio, and that was a recreational development, so I wanted to talk about that as well. Those are two examples of traditional benefit cost analysis, and it gives me a chance just to maybe point out some things that we have to wrestle with. There's a third one. I'd already introduced it. I talked about the meta-analysis, and remember, the meta-analysis was where they had aggregated lots of research in an area and then use that information to try to compile a reasonable estimate of benefits and costs. And it's kind of like doing a survey. If you get enough information, you should be approximating what we learned early in this class. You should be approximating some sort of normal distribution of information where the average should be representative of some population average. So I have that. And then I have a couple of things that move over into the territory, not so much of benefit-cost analysis, but of something called life cycle analysis. And it's something that we do where we think about the consequences of something over a long period of time, and what we're thinking about are the social costs. In this case, I've got one measure of chronic disease and another measure of the true cost of smoking, and I think those findings will surprise the heck out of you. So I'm going to move right away to the West Tarkio example here. I got to fix my computer thing here. There we go. Not West Tarkio, the Tellico Dam. Now this may be a little bit hard to see, but it's important to get up close to this stuff and look at it. And while you're getting up close and looking at it, I'm going to make my pointer the way I want it. One is I want my pointer always visible, and two, I'm going to make my pointer. Oh, let's make it a highlighter this time. I don't like the felt tip pen. The Tellico Dam versus the snail darter. Now this happened. This was the first really true test of the environmental protection laws and the whole notion that an endangered species could prevail over a public investment. And what we had on the Little Tennessee River was this dam being built, this Tellico Dam. And research found out that there was this endangered species. It's a small little fish called a snail darter. And it was endangered. And there was very little natural habitat left for this small critter. And in building the Tellico Dam, it was feared that it would make this snail darter extinct in that area. It would wipe out that species' ability to survive in that area. And so we had a classic confrontation between two things. We have a dam, and the Tennessee Valley Authority is great at building dams, and they know how to make them, and they know how to declare the benefits, and we have that, and then we got this little bitty fish. And why would this little bitty fish be able to stop this great big dam? Well, this thing goes to court. So I want to use this to basically teach us a little bit about benefit-cost analysis, and I'm not going to go into this in great detail. But what I want to point out is that we have our original TVA estimate. This is what was produced, let's say, sometimes in the 1960s. Before the Environmental Protection Act, when they were planning this project, they had their original estimate. And then the TVA estimates later on had to be reconciled with the new Endangered Species Act. And so So we've got some time period here to deal with. But let's look at this. And first of all, we have on this top what were called total benefits. And the total benefits were comprised of several things. They had something called land enhancements, where they were going to declare that as a result of the dam, the land that was surrounding that dammed area now had a different kind of value and a different kind of productivity. Its ability to produce for the economy had changed. Well, of course, it's beachside land. It's all kinds of different land. But so that was that. Now, most important was flood control. That was the next one. So the land enhancement, according to theirs, was, let's say, $1.6 million reduced back to a net present value. Flood control was $1.13 million. Golly, I don't know if these are supposed to be million or billion. It was supposed to enhance navigation. Well, we have to think about that a little bit, because when you're at the dam, you're done navigating. So the only navigating that can occur on that dam is perhaps recreational navigation, maybe a minor amount of commercial navigation, but we have to think about that. Now, it was going to generate electricity power. This is a high head dam that's going to generate power. Look at the biggest one, though, recreation, 3.7 million or billion, let's say it's million, in recreational benefits were going to be developed by this dam. That's the big chunk of the benefits, is the recreational opportunities that a dam creates. Let's hold that in mind, that we have that big chunk. Water supply, well, you know, Tennessee gets lots of rain and they don't really go through drought. So there might be some improvement in water supply, both in the quality of the water and the quantity of the water, because they do go through drought cycles. There was, of course, no benefits to agriculture in this case. This isn't going to be an irrigating territory. But last, they had something called employment. They had $8.14 million or billion dollars worth of enhancements to employment. Let me look at the values here. The dollars are in millions of 1978 dollars. I can resolve that. Okay. They had a net present value of employment of 8.14. So they're going to put this dam up, and because the dam's now there, they're claiming that there's going to be a whole lot of new jobs in this area, and that this is improvement to society, because these jobs wouldn't have occurred anywhere else in Tennessee, because but for this project, these jobs wouldn't have existed. This kind of productivity in the state wouldn't have existed. We'll look at that one. So we've got the benefits, and they declare them to be $16.5 million. And the cost of the dam, and remember, the Tennessee Valley Authority knows how to determine costs, they determined that the costs are $5.02 million. Now, they have the dam costs, and then we have something called land costs, but we'll get to that later. So they were able to declare in the 1960s that this dam would produce $11.5 million worth of net benefits, compared to a cost, $11.5 million worth of net benefits. That's benefits minus the cost, with a benefit cost ratio of almost 3.3. So this looks like a really good deal. Well, the committee that this group was asked to, the Tennessee Valley was being reviewed by, was asked to revise its figures, and they came back with some revised figures in 1977, because now they're dealing with this issue. And darned if the benefits, if I can find this thing, darned if the benefits don't go way down to $6.85 million. They've lost a whole lot of benefits. How do you lose all those benefits in that time period? Well, one, it was agreed, or it was suggested to them, that they had tremendously overestimated the land enhancements. Remember what I said, that if you improve land in one place, that comes at the expense of land in another place. That was a pecuniary shift, and you made something more valuable. Therefore, by comparison, in a fixed economy, something else had to become less valuable. So they had to make that. flood control really didn't change navigation. They were advised that there was really not going to be that much really important commercial navigation. That number went way down. They had underestimated the power benefits because during this period of time, we'd gone through energy crises and the costs of power, electricity, had gone up sharply. And so this dam actually, relative to the average cost of providing power, was going to provide more power benefits than before. The recreation benefits were lowered in this second round because it's pretty hard to argue that the people in Tennessee and along the Tennessee River don't have reasonable access to recreational opportunities. Folks, there's dams everywhere on these rivers. Water supply value went down. The value to agriculture, they had a nominal. But look at the employment values went away. And here's why the employment values were taken out. The employment values were taken out is because the area wasn't suffering from chronic unemployment. And if there was any job growth in this region, given the population supply, it would probably come at the expense of job activity or productivity somewhere else in the region. So there was no real gains to be had. Now, so benefits went down, but costs magically also went down because they lowered the dam costs. They substantially lowered the dam costs because they argued they had already been engaged over a long period of time in preparing for and developing this project, and really what we needed to count were just the current dam costs, not all of the historical dam costs. And so now my benefit cost ratio goes down to 2.15, but this project is still generating net benefits to society, according to the TVA, and according to them. Well, the committee that this information was presented to, their staff took the very same information, used their economists, and they came up with a different set of numbers. They didn't change the benefits that much. They were at 6.5 million. They really didn't change much of what the TVA did in terms of determining all of its benefits. There were some minor changes, but not much, actually, not much at all. So they really didn't change the benefits all that much, but what they did do is they changed the total costs. And the total costs were changed. They did accept the TVA's argument that the actual cost of the dam need to be realistic, but the TVA also said that it shouldn't have to account for all of the land that would have been flooded because they'd already bought that land a long time ago. Well, this committee said, no, you're wrong. You see, that land has value. Either it's underwater or it's producing something. And if it's no longer producing something, then the value of that loss needs to be calculated, and we've got to factor that in. And so they threw back in the value of the flooded land back in. Well, when they did that, now the benefit cost ratio goes down to less than one. And so what we end up with is a project with a benefit cost ratio less than one, and it's butting up against the snail darter. We're not going to look at the last one. The last one just has to do with whether you left, if you just stop building the dam altogether and you just sort of develop this place otherwise but without a dam. And we're not going to look at that one. So this is where we were with this thing. It didn't have a good benefit cost ratio. But look at where we went in a 10-year period, let's say, from just relying on the TVA's numbers versus having very aggressive scrutiny of their assumptions, and now getting to the point where everybody's looking at this because there's a court battle going on. What would a group of very smart people who worked on this for quite a while, what would they come up with? And it was significantly below the TVA. Now, the epilogue to this story is they built the dam because that was a political decision, and the snail darter didn't die. So, you know, it was a good story all the way around, but it was a great battle at its time. Let me go on to this next one. This next one is another opportunity for water supply. Out in southwest Iowa, they go through periods where they do not have adequate fresh water. Now, you have to understand, this area isn't a desert. It is an area that has lots of small reservoirs and stock dams and things like that. But, and it's got rivers going through it. It's got lots of water. But this area that in specific here suffers from some chronic water shortages because the aquifers from which they have to draw their water they're just not very plentiful, and the water's really bad. It's just really bad water. It's got high metal content, high salt content. It tastes awful, and there just isn't enough water supply capacity from underground sources. So for years they've tried to figure out ways to enhance. Well, they came up with this dam. Well, they wanted to build this dam, but the dam, just in terms of supplying fresh water to two communities, Shenandoah and Red Oak, I can't remember the other town. Anyway, skip it. It's not important. But anyway, two communities, that the benefits by having a better, more stable and a higher quality water supply and a higher volume water supply did not justify the total cost of this project of just building a freshwater reservoir, including flood control. And this is on a creek, so flood control is really a nominal issue. So what they proposed instead to boost the benefits were to develop recreational opportunities. So what they have to do, we already know they need water. That's undeniable. Now, but what they have to do to make this project work is that they have to declare, they have to accumulate a set of unmet needs for waterborne recreation in this area, and they have to document then that by providing this lake, I will provide a set of tangible, desirable benefits to a user population, and that the sum of those benefits to that user population exceed the cost. And of course, in this case, or I wouldn't be looking at it, the NRC, Natural Resource Conservation Service people came in, and this thing had an incredibly positive benefit-cost ratio. And the way they got this high benefit-cost ratio is what they did is, excuse me, I first of all, this is where it is. This is where the project is right here. I'm just highlighting it right here. It's right there in the middle. It's kind of a remote area, but it's, they don't know that, I don't have it here on the map, but it's really close to this city of reasonable size called Omaha and Council Bluffs. So they have a nice, great big population, let's say within 35, 40, 50 miles, who could potentially use this. And then, of course, I showed you this early, they also had within their 75-mile radius of potential likely users, they also had a MSA of Lincoln, Nebraska, a couple of 100,000 people, and St. Joseph's, Missouri, quite a few people as well. So they had a nice big population. And then what they said was, this population is suffering from a shortage of waterborne recreation. And they calculated all of the water area of the waterborne recreation opportunities that these people have relative to some sort of national norm. I want to, by the way, tell you that a very large fraction of the United States' population lives within 75 miles of the ocean. Therefore, their opportunities for water-based recreational opportunities are superior. Anyway, the weighted average is a little bit goofy. Okay. Now, they did all of this, and they calculated all of this stuff, and then they said this place is in serious deficit of water-based recreation opportunities, plus other opportunities like hunting and fishing and bird watching and all kinds of things. Well, there's all kinds of things that were done wrong in this thing, but one of the things that struck me is really funny. In calculating the water area that was available to this entire population, they chose not to include the Missouri River or the Platte River flowing into the Missouri River or any number of rivers that are on that area, that are in that area. And they just basically said that water doesn't count. That's not waterborne recreation. There are all kinds of things that they did, but the point of it was they defined the need to be substantially greater than the supply by minimizing the supply and very much maximizing the potential users. And I leave it up to you, given the things that you can do in Missouri or all of the things you can do in Nebraska, to determine what the probability of somebody living in Lincoln or St. Joseph's, Missouri, of participating in a recreational opportunity in southwest Iowa. The answer is it's really, really low. But they estimated it to be really, really high. And so then you had this thing. The other problem with this project is that it wasn't truly all government funded. The two little communities would have had to pay $25 million, half of the cost of this project. Yet the determinants of the benefits accumulated primarily externally to all of those people in Lincoln and Omaha and St. Joseph's, because that's the people they needed to come up with the unmet need and the benefits calculations. So we have a classic example of something. The local people who would pay for half of this project would never realize anywhere near the life of this project the benefits to pay them back for their local, whether it was a sales tax or whether they bonded for it or whatever. The local people, no matter what, would have never realized cumulative benefits to their locality in amounts sufficient over 50 years to come anywhere near to paying for that. And so we also had an imbalance between who's paying for the benefits versus who may receive the benefits. So we had a terrible imbalance. And it was very, very hard to explain to these local folks that they're being taken for a ride and they're going to be worse off, because they could only see the great big numbers. And this had morphed from not just water supply anymore to rural economic development, and that this was going to stabilize or otherwise enhance or enliven this rural area. So it was an area that was out of balance. The epilogue to this story is both of the participating communities voted against. They first voted for, the counties and the two communities voted for the project. Subsequently, by the time more information came in, they both voted against it, and they refused then to participate in this project. Undaunted, the NRCS got another project in South Central Iowa funded and, I mean, approved by local governments, and now is going to be funded, even though it has characteristics exactly like this one, with inflated recreation numbers. And the difference in that one is that there was just no way to counter it, and they got their way. All righty, let's move on. I don't want to beat this to death, but I wanted to give you a sense of this stuff. Remember, the benefits are accumulating to society by me receiving a good that I can't otherwise get, which, like recreation opportunities, that's a good. I'm willing to pay for that. Or my life has been made better off as a consequence of the investment. My travel time goes down. My income goes up. My ability to purchase goods and services has increased because the average aggregate cost of goods and services has been lowered for some reason. That's what the benefits are. Don't forget, the benefits are accumulating to society broadly, not to a specific group of people or a specific industry or something like that. And always remember, the costs are the public's costs. Now we have the meta-analysis example, and I have this reading, so I want you to take a good look. I don't want you to read the whole thing, but at least get through the executive summary and scan the rest of it. But this was a program, an analysis done at Washington State Institute for Public Policy back in 2004. The benefits and costs of prevention and early intervention programs for youth. Now, this really asks a very important question. Does prevention pay? And we know prevention pays. We know it in health care. We know it in dental care. We know prevention matters. We have fluoride in our toothpaste. You know, we have all kinds of things. We have inoculations of infants. We know that disease prevention pays off in the long run. So the answer is, can an ounce of prevention, a benefit, avoid at least an ounce of cure, which is a cost. So prevention yields sets of benefits, and prevention as in reduced negative outcomes of some sort. So more specifically for public policy purposes, is there credible scientific evidence that for each dollar a legislature spends on research-based prevention or early intervention programs for youth, we're talking about children and adolescents, would we get more than a dollar's worth of benefits out of the whole deal? This is the classic benefit cost. And if so, what are the policy options that offer taxpayers the best return? Now, they use the word return on investment, but best return relative to the public's cost. Now, people use the term return on investment. It's a sloppy term, and you shouldn't use it in the public sector. If I'm in the private sector, a return on investment means I am investing money, I am getting a return on my investment, plus when I want to, I get my original investment back. I get my money back. So that's what a return on investment means. And if you're in the private sector, that means that I'm getting an income stream in dividends, interests, or rents of some kind over a period of time. And then over some period of time, I can get my asset value back. I know what a return on investment is if I'm in the private sector. In the public sector, that language does not have an appropriate, agreed upon use. And I would argue and urge you to never use those three words in a public setting unless you're talking about a private investment. That's just my very strident bias. So let's look at this. They wanted to reduce crime. Now, we're not talking about, are we investing in crime prevention? No. We're providing a public policy, a program that is designed to help children. Okay, you can call it investment if you want, but it's just sloppy talk, sloppy language, and don't do it. We want to reduce crime. We want to lower and reduce the incidences of substance abuse. We want to improve educational outcomes. These are some of the things they were going to look at. And graduation rates, because we know a dropout is a trigger into all kinds of undesirable outcomes. We want to decrease teen pregnancies, and notwithstanding the last presidential elections example, we want to decrease teen pregnancies because we know that that leads to a period of time of high dependency and issues. We want to reduce teen suicides, lower child abuse or neglect, and try to figure out those, and reduce domestic violence. So what they did is they looked at all the scientific-based research that was out there. They amassed it, and they accumulated the sets of benefits. They standardized those benefits in a way. They amassed all of the costs associated with those things. And so they put together a great big population of research that they used to it. So that basically they were able to calculate by category, not just in total, by category. And here's what they found. The highest net benefit was programs for juvenile offenders. They were yielding from anywhere, depending on the range and the project and where it was going on, from $1,900 to $3,100 per youth served. Those are net benefits. Compared to maybe the cost of incarceration or the cost of property damage or theft or other kinds of things. Some form of home visiting programs for targeted high-risk and low-income mothers and children were also effective. You're improving parenting skills. Maybe you're improving nutrition skills. Maybe you're improving the social skills of both the mother and of the child. And or you're providing services that help for some in-home educational remediation. Those produce relatively strong returns per youth. Early childhood education for low-income 3- and 4-year-olds they use the word returns on investment, provided very attractive benefits relative to the sums of the costs. And while their net benefits are relatively low, many of the substance abuse prevention programs were determined to be cost-effective because basically those kinds of programs are not very expensive when you're talking about dealing with a large population of at-risk children and you bring in sets of substance abuse training and or teaching programs periodically. The average cost per child served is reasonably low. Few programs were able to demonstrate a reduction in teen pregnancy, which tells us that the issue of teen pregnancy tends to exist outside of government activity and or public institutional activity, that it's separate and, it's a problem, that it basically says we need new programs, to deal with that issue. And a few of the early intervention programs were not cost-effective and very expensive and produced few benefits, and therefore they recommended the legislature to be careful about funding those programs. So they used this great big study to really sort out where might the legislature get the biggest benefit bang for the public buck. Okay? And so this was a good study. Let's move on. Here's one that I had. It was the Milken Institute. An Unhealthy America, the Economic Burden of Chronic Disease. Now, in this case, it was looking at chronic illnesses and it was really thinking in terms of what were the costs, the medical resources that were used to treat sets of avoidable illnesses, to include an impact on the labor supply. And by labor supply, my ability to work, if I'm here working and I'm healthy, I'm considered a fully productive person. If I'm here working but I'm periodically unhealthy, then my employer suffers. My productivity goes down, and society ultimately suffers because you're getting less out of me because I'm unhealthy. And it has an impact on gross domestic product because, I have an extra cost associated with my work, either a work-based cost or a personal cost that keeps me from being as productive. And does this have a drag on long-term economic growth in our society? Well, the, areas of preventable illness, and we all know what they are, things associated with, unhealthy lifestyles, cancer, smoking especially, but you could also think in terms of diet and nutrition. Heart disease and hypertension, these are all things that are linked to smoking. They're also things that are linked to an absence of fitness as well as being overweight. I'm going to skip one here. Diabetes, pulmonary conditions, and stroke. Again, these are all linked to aging, of course, but smoking and being overweight and not having. Now, one of the areas they had in there was mental illness, as in an area in which people's mental health, there are dimensions of mental well-being that can be intervened with to improve early on. There are mental health preventive things that can go on. We don't take mental illness in and of itself as something that, we can necessarily prevent by because we can identify it. In an early screening and detection may identify some mental illness, but I will grant them that some mental illnesses can be considered preventable. So what were the treatments? They were weight control combined with improved nutrition, exercise, programs to reduce smoking, aggressive early disease detection, which would be periodic checkups, faster adoption of improved therapies and less invasive treatments for people, rather than cancer or surgeries for some things. For example, maybe exercise, diet, and lifestyle changes could thing this. And from that, they identified the costs of all of this, basically this unhealthy living. And what they found out is they were able to say, well, our current path has a set of expenditures, and these are in trillions of dollars, $8.8 trillion or $800 billion worth of treatment expenditures are what we would expect through going out to 2023, just given the way we're going right now, and $3.4 billion worth of reduced lost economic output for a total cost to society of $4.2 billion. Now, the alternative path were sets of these improvements, diet, lifestyle, nutrition, weight management, exercise, and adoption of new technologies done. The current, the alternative path would have resulted in a reduction of the total costs down to $3.1 trillion, or a savings over this time period of $900 billion in terms of avoided costs or treatment expenditures and improved productivity. Now, this isn't being done on a benefit cost, but what it is being done on is to be able to demonstrate to society what the potential gains are were we to engage in many of these things. Then the next step would be to say, okay, given this current path, this baseline, what might be the most effective mechanisms among those choices, improved nutrition, exercise, further reductions in smoking, early disease detection, what mix of that programming and public spending would produce the best mix of desired outcomes here? So this is what we think of in terms of a trying to figure out a long-term set of costs, but it costs to society. It's a backhanded way to say what might be the benefits to society, the improvement to society be if we're able to institute these changes. And so I thought I'd throw this example. There's no benefit cost analysis going on here. Last one, here's a life cycle summation, and I love this one. This is in yours as well to read. Also remember, I did summarize these on a handout, and so you can look at this as well. The research question here is very important. They want to know in a very basic way, what do people literally lose economic for smoking or from smoking over their lifetime? This is one of the on the first labor market estimates of what's called the value of a statistical life. We get into some touchy territory here by saying what yours and my life values are, and then what are the consequences to our life value as a consequence of dying sooner. But using their valuation methodology, and it gets a little complicated, but you can read the introduction to this and you can certainly follow along and especially understand the conclusions, that the mortality risk of smoking over the life cycle of smoking increases. We know smoking's bad for you. And so what they produce is estimates of the value of smoking by virtue of the value of your life lost due to your accumulating increased mortality versus if nobody smoked. And then they calculate that, they estimate all of that, they sum it all up versus what your productivity in life or your life would have been worth had you lived a normal life and not died from smoking. So it's basically the difference between the average lifespan at any age group along the way between a smoker and a non-smoker, recognizing that if you're a smoker, your risk of mortality increases immediately as you continue to smoke, and it gets greater as you smoke longer. So what did they find out in this? It's incredible. They produced an estimate of the private mortality cost of smoking. Remember, this is based on the statistical value of your life of $220 per pack for men and $94 per pack for women. Now, this isn't what you're paying for smoking. This is what you're losing in terms of life living as a consequence of smoking. Basically, it's the value of what would have been the rest of your life had you been able to enjoy it were it not for your smoking habit. And so it's $220, $222 per pack for men, $94 per pack for women. That's reflective of the fact that men have a higher mortality rate due to smoking than women, although women have been catching up in recent years, and of the fact also that women make less than men. And so that darn gender thing calculates in there. Now that's based on a discount rate of 3%, and this was done in $2006. And remember that example. If the discount rate goes up, the value of the benefit, in this case the benefit of living longer, goes down, and that decreases the cost about $25 per pack for men. So what did they do? Well, they were able to calculate the value of a statistical life for men of all ages and women of all ages, right here. So we can get this value of a statistical life in total, which is the sum. The total is the sum of the years you would have been expected to live longer and be productive in society had you not smoked. So that's the value of your statistical life. That's your difference. And the value of your statistical life per year is just the value per year of that extra lifetime that you're able to live. And so if you divided the value of a statistical life by the value of statistical life per year, that's telling you the average number of years longer that you might have lived as a concept if you'd quit smoking. Okay, so that's what this does. That's what this does. And it just gives you a sense of the value of something. Now, again, the benefits to be accumulated are massive here. They're massive here. These are benefits accumulating to individuals, but this is just part of the story. What we would look at are the lowered cost to the public by eliminating smoking, the increased in just the overall, not just the value of your statistical life, but your quality of life by not slowly dying, by living a more healthy and more productive and we would assume a happier life because you're healthier. So this is just one little piece of something that we might do. Most of the time when you do benefit cost analysis, you don't deal with this stuff all that much, but it is something that you could look at. So I thought it would be interesting to introduce you to it. Most of the time when you do benefit cost analysis, you do something like the first two examples. We build a road, we build a dam, we build a bridge, we improve the lock and dams on the Missouri River, and we have a set of physical infrastructure. But that meta-analysis was also very interesting because it was demonstrating sets of net benefits that could accumulate, whether in the aggregate or in the average, that could accumulate to a policymaker if they implemented some average set of programs to deal with children's needs. And those programs would be the public cost, and those returns would be lowered public costs, perhaps, and improved productivity on the part of the children. And those are benefits because people are better off. Well, that's the end of benefit cost analysis at least in terms of how I'm going to teach it. You've lasted through 10 sessions here and gone through it relatively fast, but I think you're going to have a good sense of it. Now, you're going to need a good sense of it to be able to answer the final assignment questions. And the next very short session is going to go over the final assignment, and then we'll be done with this class. And look forward to seeing you then.